I decided that it was about time that I make a tutorial video of some kind, so I went online and I asked you guys what you might want to see. What are the few things that would pop up again and again as questions that several of you had? And so the two things that really stood out to me were creating shadows and saving or preparing my images for print. So those are the two things that I'm going to talk about in this video. First, let's talk about shadows. Now I have this image pulled up right now as something that we're going to work on to create shadows because the shadows that you see here did not originally exist, at least not all of them, in the original picture. So I'm going to talk about how to create shadows in three different methods, and I'm also going to talk about how I would then save this image if I were going to print. In order to create shadows that are believable, we have to study shadows in real life or through our images. So I have two images pulled up, this one and this one, and they represent two very different types of shadows. The shadow that you see here is a very harsh shadow. It's a shadow that is a result of direct sunlight coming in from the left-hand side of the screen, slightly above the subject. And so this shadow has a very crisp edge and it's very dark. It's also on a light-colored background, meaning the road, and that means that it's going to show up a lot better than if it were on something dark. So those are things that I'm considering: the direction of light, the quality of the light, and what the background is. If I look at this image, I have a very soft shadow, meaning that the edges of the shadow are blurred. You can see, though, where the shadow becomes darker and lighter based on a couple of different things: if the shadow is crossing over each other, or where the subject is in relation to where the shadow is being projected. The shadow is being projected on the wall mostly here, and that's where our eye goes when we're looking for the shadow. Now, her head is up higher off the ground and further away from the wall based on how she's leaning. That means that the top of the shadow where her head is going to be lighter and more faded because she's further away from where the shadow is being projected. Her arm here is where the light source crosses over, therefore it's a lot darker in that area, meaning that there is a light source coming from a window over here and a light source coming from a window over here. That's what's creating the shadow in the very back right behind her. You can see how it's a little bit darker back on the wall here. But then the window over here, which is our main light source, is creating the darker shadow right behind her. Now, I've studied this. I know that if I were to, let's say, remove her from this image or put somebody in the blank shot that I took in this space, I now know what the shadow should look like. That doesn't mean that you can't fake it a little bit if you were to drop somebody in this background and start fresh. However, if you bother to take a picture of somebody in the space that you're going to drop somebody into later, then you'll already know what it should look like with perspective, how many shadows there should be, how dark they should be, and how harsh they should be. This is the image that I ended up finishing with, but I'm going to go back to square one where I first started, and that was right here with this image. So that means that I have a lot of work to do. I can also see, based on this image, what the sky was like, so I know now what the lighting was like. I can also see what the shadow was like in the original image. So here I'm just going to put on the dress that was created very quickly. And now I know what I'm working with. I know where the shadow needs to be. If something is closer to the surface where the shadow is being projected, then that shadow needs to be a little bit harsher and a little bit darker in that area. You can see here with her dress where it dips down, that is closer to the ground. That means that that spot right there needs to have a darker shadow than, say, over here where the dress is up a little bit higher. So let's go ahead and create those shadows, and that's going to help us to create a more believable image. Something to keep in mind here when I'm creating these shadows is that there are three methods. One is to cut out the thing that you are creating a shadow of, move that cutout down, blur it, and darken it. And that means that you're going to now create a shadow based on the exact shape of the thing that you're creating a shadow of. That is sometimes useful and sometimes not. Now in this case, we just want a little strip of a shadow underneath our subject, so that's not going to be the best method. But let me go over what that would look like anyway. I'm going to use my lasso tool. I'm using a Wacom tablet right now, so I have free range of my wrist. And I'm just going to, and very roughly, I'm not really concerned about what I have in this selection, just making sure I have the general shape. I'm going to go ahead and draw right around the thing that I'm creating a shadow of. And now, for the sake of time, I'm going to merge these layers, copy, and paste. So now what I have is this, an exact cutout of the skirt. So now when I move that down, or anywhere, I can now create a shadow. So let's go ahead and do that up here, just so we can see exactly what's going to happen. First of all, I know that I need to create a really soft shadow based on the fact that there's no direct light. So I'm going to go to Filter, Blur, Gaussian Blur, or Box Blur would work just fine. And I'm going to go ahead and blur that. Now I'm looking specifically at the edges. I'm not looking to see how out of focus it is, just how blurred the edges are. So I'm going to take that up, and I think that that might be a pretty good way to start. That's 67 pixels. So I'll say okay to that. And now the next thing that I need to do is make this whole entire layer, this whole entire dress piece that I cut out, completely black. So let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to go to curves on that layer, and I'm just going to make it completely black and say okay. Now I can move this into place wherever we want it to be. Let's say we want the shadow to be behind her. Now, of course, we just have a black blob, and that's not good. So we're going to go ahead and lower the opacity now, so that now we've created a shadow. Now, the great thing now is that you can create a layer mask with your brush tool on black, making sure the hardness of your brush is down so you have a nice soft eraser here. And you can go ahead and just erase that where you don't want it. So if you felt it was too much on the feet, you can get rid of that. I actually really like it on the feet, so I'm just going to leave it there. You can also lower the opacity as well of your brush, so if you would like to erase just a bit, then you can always do that as well. Now this goes back too far, so I can just mold this into whatever shape I want with my eraser tool. So that's one way to create a shadow, and the way that this would work best is, let's say that you have a bird in the sky that you want to create a shadow of. That would work really well because you need the exact shape of the bird to create the shadow. Things that are already cut out that you have pasted in are really great for this because the shape is already cut out, so you can simply duplicate the layer, make it darker, blur it, and then move that shadow wherever it needs to be. This is also really good for very directional light. So let's say you have a lamp casting a side light on an object. Creating a shadow like that would be the most beneficial way to go. Over here is an image that I'm still in the process of working on, but here we have a kite, and that kite is already cut out. So this is a perfect example of how you would want to use this method of creating shadows. Down here is where we have our kite layer. It is already cut out on a separate layer. So I'm just going to duplicate that layer and then move that up to the top of our layers so that we have something to work on here that we can see. Now if I go to my move tool, I can move that kite around, and now you can see that I can do whatever I want with that. So I'm going to go ahead and make it darker, same way that I did before with curves. Just make it completely black, and now I'm going to go ahead and blur it just like we did before. And I think something a little bit less would work better here. 40 pixels is about good. And now I can put that shadow wherever I want the shadow to be. So let's say right there for now, and we can lower that opacity, and now we're creating a shadow on the ground of the kite. So that's where this works best. Now, it doesn't work in this picture because we don't need a shadow of the kite on the ground. It's simply too high up in the air to actually project a shadow on the ground, especially with such diffuse light. However, that is an example of where this method would work best. So back to the main image that we're working on. I'm going to get rid of that shadow layer that we've just created, and instead I'm going to show you two more ways of creating a shadow. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go up to the top of our layers. I'm going to create a curves layer. And this is an adjustment layer, meaning that I've created it from the bottom of my layers panel. And that means that I can now erase this or turn it off if I don't like the curves adjustment that I've just made. So from my highlights, I'm simply going to pull down and make the whole image darker. Okay? And now I'm going to use that layer mask that's already created on my curves layer with the brush tool. I'm going to make that brush pretty big. And now I'm going to erase it everywhere that I don't want it. So this is one method where I could simply go ahead and erase, but as you can see, that's going to take a lot of time. So instead of doing that, I'm just going to go back in history there, click on my layer mask, and I'm actually going to invert this. I'm on a Mac, so that'll be Command-I. And now you can see that I've simply gotten rid of that mask without actually taking it off of my layers palette. Now, when I'm on my layer mask and I switch to white, I can now bring back that shadow wherever I want. Now that is way too harsh, and that's because I'm bringing it back at full opacity. So let's go ahead and lower our brush, so then it's a much, much lighter brush. We'll make that size a little bit smaller. And now we can start to put a shadow in underneath the dress, wherever we think it might need to go. So that's another method of creating shadows wherever you might want them. And that's a really good method. It's not the method that I use most often though. The method that I use is to simply use the lasso tool and draw wherever you think the shadow needs to go, just like this, and then right click and refine edge. Now choosing refine edge is going to show you what your selection looks like. It also gives you a feather slider, which is going to soften the edges of your selection. So now I can go ahead and choose how much of a soft edge I want. And then with a curves adjustment layer, I can go ahead and create that shadow, as you can see. Now this is good, except that as I talked about, wherever the dress is closer to the ground, that needs to have more of a shadow. And so I can go ahead and now create another selection, feathering that selection just underneath where it needs to be a little bit darker, and create another curves layer to make it darker just in that spot. That's going to create a believable shadow in most situations, so all you have to do is assess the situation. What do your shadows need to look like? Should they be harsh or should they be soft? Is the lighting direct or is it indirect? Do they need to be dark or not? And are there multiple shadows involved? These are all of the questions that we need to ask ourselves. Hopefully this helps you in creating shadows in the future, creating more believable images. Now on to saving this image. So if I'm going to save this for print, first thing that I'm going to do is image size. And I'm just going to check out what we're working with. Now in this particular image, I am at 6,000 by 6,000 pixels. I happen to work in square, so that's pretty typical for me. And this is simply depending on how much I crop or expand my image. Now if I crop my image, then typically my pixel count is about 3,500 by 3,500 pixels. That means that I'm not going to be able to print as large as I would like. However, I'm not opposed to cropping my images, so that's perfectly okay. I have printed images of that size at about 40 inches, I would say, is about the max I would go depending on what the image is. However, I would probably stick to around 30 inches, and that's just what makes me comfortable personally. 6,000 pixels is a really great place to start. That means that I can print all of my personal edition sizes. So that's sort of my aim. My goal is to get my images to about 6,000 or more pixels. You can see here that the document size is 20 inches, and you can pretty easily double that size. My resolution is always at 300 pixels per inch. And so that is all looking good. This is the image that I want to use as my final image. And so I really just want to flatten these layers. And you can do that by right clicking and then choosing flatten image. Discard hidden layers, I simply say yes because I know that this looks exactly as I need it to look. And after that is finished flattening, then I'm going to go ahead and save it. Now there are a couple of ways that you can save your images, and I simply do what my printer has requested. So I'm going to go to File, Save As, and I'll save this to my desktop for now. Instead of saving it as a Photoshop file, I'm saving it as a TIFF file. Now the way that I name my images is to name it with my last name underscore the title. And that way I can always find my images, it always has my name attached to it. That way when I send them to my printer, he always knows whose image it is. So I'll simply save it like that. When the TIFF options come up, I always say compression none. So now I have that TIFF file saved. That's what I typically do. Now let's say that I didn't want to print this at 20 by 20 inches, which is the document size that we saw earlier. In that case, I'm going to go to image size, and I'm going to go ahead and change this document size to whatever I want it to be. So if I'm going to print this at 40 inches, I'm going to change that to 40 inches and say OK. Now yes, that is going to stretch the image, but that's what we have to do as photographers when we are enlarging our images. I will then simply zoom in on it and then just sort of go through the image sort of line by line to make sure that at that size everything still looks OK. And once I'm sure that it does look okay, I will go to File, Save As, and do the same thing again. Now, typically, if I am being very organized, then I will actually go ahead and save all of my images at all of the potential sizes that I'm going to save them at. And in that case, I'll do a little bit of a number at the end, so it says 40 by 40. And that way, when I save this, I will know that that is the 40 by 40 size that has already been proofed that I can send directly to my printer should somebody request a print of that image. I really hope that this has been helpful for you. I have very much enjoyed making it. So if you ever have any other suggestions on anything that you'd like to know, please send that in to me via email, Twitter, Facebook, anything like that is just fine. If you're interested in learning more techniques for my editing, I have a few options for you. On Creative Live, I recently taught a class called Fine Art Compositing, where I go through most of my Photoshop process start to finish, as well as many little tips and tricks in between. I also teach workshops, and most recently, I have a convention coming up in October where I will be sitting down with small groups of people going over whatever questions they might have, editing included, and so I would love to see you there. Thank you so much for watching.